is a something I never grow weary of.
Yes.
Being with kindred spirits, I'm very grateful that I don't have to grow old without that.
Yes.
We welcome, as usual, our live stream audience. Even though we're not personally with you, we're grateful we can have this type of communication.
Amen.
We're continuing the Gospel of John tonight. This will be our 57th exposition of this text. We're going to begin the fifth chapter tonight, the first four verses. I'd like to say a word before we begin that when you read Scripture, it's necessary to distinguish the writings of Scripture from just being historical. I'd forgot about the use of that word historical till we moved here to Joplin, and I heard it used, the historical Christ, the historical church, and all this. I don't like that kind of that kind of language. There are in the prophets, for instance, the prophets have some recounting of what happened in the past, but their major thrust is prophecy. That's the major thrust of them. There are some books in Scripture that the major thrust are the events that happened, like Genesis through Job. Those kind of books. They're recounting to you something that happened. Daniel, Jonah, Zechariah, the Gospels, and Acts. That's the same. They're accounting for things that happened, but they're not what we call history.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They're recounting what God has done. See, they're recounting the divine agenda being worked out among men. They're not just reporting what happened.
Yeah.
Most of what happened isn't written, because it is not germane to what God is doing. It is probably, it'd be too difficult to make the correlation, but I think it's important to remember that, because if we view the Scriptures incorrectly, then we're going to see Jesus incorrectly, we're going to see God incorrectly, we're going to see salvation incorrectly, see?
Amen.
In fact, in my opinion, that is why more value is not placed on salvation and being accepted by God, is because there's a kind of a skewed view of Scripture that is viewed as it happened back there 2,000 years ago. People talk about Jesus died 2,000 years ago. That's not the way to say it. In the fullness of time, he died. That's the way to say it. See? The word history might be interesting to know. It does not occur in the King James Bible or the New American Standard Bible. The word history isn't even there. Some places where it is used, like the New International Version, New Revised Standard Version, and so forth, where those versions use the word history, the versions that don't use it use the word generations or records. See, but there's quite a bit of difference between history and generations. Generation speaks as a progression of something, and records speaks of some something inspired being given. So that's not something that I'm willing to make a big issue out of, you understand, but I want to underscore the fact that what men call history in Scripture, there are segments of time in which God was accomplishing something. How you have to view it. If you view it as just something that happened, you miss it. See, you miss it. And Satan has been very cunning in the way he has moved people to approach Scripture. He gradually depowers it, so that eventually people don't have to expose themselves to it. They just neglect the reading of Scripture, even because they've got the wrong idea about Scripture. This This is your index to God.
Amen.
If you miss this, you've missed it altogether.
Right.
Yeah, we got creation. Nobody got that message.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The eternal power in Godhead is clearly seen in creation, but not one person in the history of the world ever got the message.
Mm-hmm.
It had to be told.
Yeah.
See? Yes.
Well, I hear that word historical. When people use that word when describing events in Scripture, they're usually talking about it as from a source that's independent of God, like independent of Scripture. Like when they say, like, historical Jesus, that's like Jesus apart from the Scripture. In my own hearing people talk about historical, like when they say the historical Jesus, they never say anything significant about that Jesus.
Yeah,
because it's more has its basis in just like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a dumbed down view.
So yes, exactly.
You'd say you can't make like a big issue out of it. That's kind of what I'm targeting. I'm just saying that there's, if you stretch together a number of things like this that happened, then pretty soon the Bible is literature. That's what it is, and a lot of people view it just that way.
Again, you said not to make a great big deal about it, but still, history, as commonly understood, is segmented and given from perspective of men.
Absolutely.
Like if you go back to, let's say, recent history, the Civil War, that's pretty recent so far as it. You got to read a whole bunch of accounts to get the whole picture, whereas a record is something that is an account that was taken at the time it happened. It isn't just a person's perspective on what happened or their recollection on what happened. And with generations, that has to do again more with the actual accounting of events as they occurred or as they were revealed.
Amen. Now, I said these things because we're dealing with a record of something Jesus did, but it's more than a record. It's a revelation. See, we're going to see something of God in it. So we're going to be in the fifth chapter and the first four verses. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. Now, if that was folklore, that would have been an excellent place for the Spirit to say, this is what men thought. But see, now let's look at this. There's a lot more than you might think in this text. Or maybe there's more even than I saw. If you see more, you by all means share it with us. I want to look first at this, after this, that expression, after this, that phrase is mentioned 53 times in Scripture. After this is mentioned 5 times in the Gospels. Now it has more to do than with chronology. In the events of Scripture, each of them are like peaks of mountains. It's not a linear account of what happened. It's peaks. Something significant happened, then something else significant happened, and he's tracking the working of the Lord. God is building your conception of God and your perception of Christ. See, and the way you see salvation. He's building it as he goes through.
Amen.
So time is a segment in which God is working out something or revealing something about himself. And we know this is the case because when Jesus was here, he only did what God gave him to do. That's important to note that. And he's not talking about getting up in the morning and going to bed. He's not talking about things like that. When he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, he was following a very strict agenda.
Yeah.
Now, he spoke about it. John 8:28. I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Now that's true of any personality that has ever come down from heaven.
Yeah.
The preeminent person is Christ, but there's angels. There's no angel ever came from heaven to earth unless God sent him and he was doing God's will.
Yeah.
There'd been no other visitation by angels. Yeah. Nobody in heaven thinks so much of the earth that they want to visit it once in a while. No, that's the way it is now. Even God has to, so to speak, come down to investigate things like the Tower of Babel and so forth. It isn't that he doesn't know. That is, it's a humbling. For God to have anything to do with humanity is humbling. And only God can work out a righteous way of resolving that situation. He gave man, 4,000 years to come up with something, but only God could resolve that situation, and he did. He's also said that he only spoke what a father taught him to say. You say, well, wasn't Jesus omniscient? No. But when he entered earth, he wasn't. He grew in wisdom.
Amen.
That's how low he had to come to save us. Now he said when he was here, as he grew, when he went about ministry and there wasn't anything hid from him, we understand that.
Yeah.
But 30 years for him to get prepared for that.
Right.
And when he went about, he only said what his father taught him to say. He said, the psalmist depicts him as saying, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. And in Hebrews 10, he quotes it. So God divulged as a man. This is speaking of God dealing with him as a man. Divulged with him. And then Jesus said, I can do nothing of myself. Not legally I can do nothing of myself. I have divested myself, he was saying, of the prerogatives of deity.
Yeah.
I didn't come to the earth to save men as God.
That's right.
That was why I just done it from heaven.
Uh-huh.
I came to save men as a man,
yeah,
the man Christ Jesus. Satan had to be defeated by a man for any benefit to pass to us.
Mm-hmm.
So I only came to do that. Now the word after this, those words, are telling us he's moving to the next mountain peak, is what's happening. This is not just simply a report of what happened, it's a report of what God is doing. And I think if we saw it clearly, we'd find that there was a logical progression from his dealing with that sinful woman at Simon the Pharisee's house. There was a logical progression, if we could. I can't see it clearly, you understand, but I think you'd see that this was just made a lot of sense in a heavenly agenda to proceed to this event we're going to read about. The next agenda on the divine agenda, the next event on the divine agenda. Now we understand that God's will is not helter-skelter.
Uh-huh.
It's not sporadic.
Yeah.
Today, some will, no one will tomorrow. It's not spontaneous. This is not the way God works. Now we know the Bible begins, Scripture begins, by showing you how God works, the creation. See, that's an introduction to how God works. It's purposeful, it's orderly, it's effective, and it's pure. This is how God works. There was a progression in creation. This is how God works. Now that when he works in salvation, it's the same type of thing. He's progressing in the work of saving men and laying the foundation for. See, what had to happen, there has to be a foundation. God has to have a reason to save man.
Amen.
It's not enough that he loves man. That's not enough.
Yeah.
He's righteous.
Yeah.
Righteousness wouldn't let him save men just because he loved them. No.
Amen.
See, there had to come a time when mercy and peace kissed each other.
That's right. Yeah.
See, that has to happen. And so he's working this out.
Yes.
Because once salvation is in place, it's got to be a salvation, and no one can lay anything to the charge of God's elect. It's got to be absolutely foolproof and effective. So this is the next event on that calendar. We also, not only do we see God's orderly way of working in creation, in the raising up of the Jewish nation, starting with Abraham.
Yes.
It's a progressive, you see, this is how God works. He builds.
Yes.
He starts out with a purpose, and he builds that purpose, brings it to pass.
It's not so much that God had to make sure that salvation was something that the devil couldn't argue against. It had to be something that he approved of.
Oh, yeah. It had
because
to be
righteous. That would be an ironclad plan if God himself, if his righteousness was pleased with it.
That's right. Yeah,
yeah, God's preeminent trait is righteousness.
Yes.
Everything
yes.
filters through his righteousness. It has to be righteous. And that's why salvation is so intricate, mm-hmm. taking away sin, destroying the devil, plundering principalities and powers. You know, see, all this is very complicated things.
Yeah.
But they were necessary for God to be right. That He had to be both just and the justifier of him that believed in Christ. Now, I must confess that it was a while before I saw this. But my theology is what kept me from seeing it. That's what kept me from seeing it. Because I wasn't a half-hearted disciple. I was not a half-hearted disciple. But I had embraced a view, I didn't realize I'd done it, but I had embraced a view that actually hid God.
Yeah.
The view I had actually obscured God. The most wonderful traits of God were it hid them. Such as the grace of God and the righteousness of God. So this, what God is doing here, he's providing a context in which Jesus is going to lay down his life. See, there had to be a certain kind of a environment for this death to be accomplished. Because when Jesus rose from the dead, the Holy Spirit was going to recall to the disciples things Jesus said. And if there wasn't a context, proper context, that remembrance wouldn't be profitable. Without developing any further, I hope you can see that. So far as Jesus is concerned, it's interesting to observe that in Scripture there's no record of any person of God keeping a feast that was invented by men, like a national holiday or something. Now, I'm not opposed to, observing national holidays. I'm just pointing out that there isn't anything like this in Scripture. They had feasts and holidays and things like this, make no mistake about it, but there's no example of them being practiced. Jesus left us an example. Mm-hmm. And it didn't have to do with how he responded to Herod. It was just pretty much he turned that off.
Yeah. Yeah.
He never did get involved in the political affairs. Unless there's something there that I have missed. He just didn't get involved in that. Why? Because it was distracting to what he was here.
Yes, amen.
To what he was here to do. So he just said, tell Herod, go tell that fox. I'll give him my agenda, what I'm going to do today and tomorrow and the day following. See if he can do anything about that.
Yeah,
yeah, that's what Jesus did.
Amen.
Now, Jesus said to his disciples, by this thing of being an example, he's living out God's purpose, what things that are pertinent to being saved. He washed the disciples' feet. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also should wash one another's feet.
Yes.
For I've given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. What did he mean? In Christ you get and you give.
Yes. Yeah.
Don't you dare be a disciple that gets upset because people don't pay enough attention to you. You're out of order. You be concerned about how much attention you pay to them. You wash their feet.
Yes. Amen.
Hmm? You see, it's the principle of the kingdom. This is how salvation works. It makes the person not only a receptor, but one that does something also. I give you an example. And then Peter said, Jesus gave us an example of suffering, who did no sin, neither was any guile in his mouth. So Jesus gave an example how to suffer with your mouth shut.
Yeah.
That's how you suffer. So if you're having a hard time with people, move on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus gave you an example of what to do. At his worst trial, he opened not his mouth. You'd be like a deliverance. Let me tell you something. If you actually practice this, you don't open your mouth, you'll get grace. It won't be hard. Pretty soon, it won't even be hard to do. In our time, there's an attempt to look at Christ with current life in mind. So they choose the word relevant. Is it relevant? You know. But this is not how life is to be viewed. It isn't whether Jesus fits in here, it's whether we fit in there.
Yeah.
See, that's the...
Amen.
Salvation's about adapting you
yes.
for glory.
Amen.
It's not about adapting Jesus to here. In fact, he'll help you to raise up into a higher realm than here. Now, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. We've mentioned this before. Jerusalem was up from anywhere. It pretty much was that way geographically, but it was from a spiritual perspective. Anyone from wherever they were, if they were out east, out west, they went up to Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Anyone that left Jerusalem went down. Even if they went north, they went down. And you trace all those records, it's always that way. He went up to Jerusalem. We assume it was to observe. Well, it was to observe one of the feasts. It's not named. The feast isn't named. Went up to Jerusalem. Now, there were three major feasts the Jews participated in, particularly all the males. They were all after the wilderness, after they got into Canaan, they were all observed in Jerusalem. When they're in the wilderness, they were observed at a place God would name where. But when they got to in the promised land, they were all observed in Jerusalem, high place. As far as we know, Jesus went to Jerusalem four times in his life. The first was when he was 12, went up with his parents to Passover. And there's three other occasions mentioned when he went up during a feast to Jerusalem. It made sense to go there. That's where God placed his name, was in Jerusalem. That is, this is the one city, the only city, on the face of the earth or in the history that was connected with God.
Yeah.
Jerusalem. Put his name there. And a temple was built there, and Jesus referred to it as my Father's house.
Yeah.
I dedicate that to everybody that thinks a building is wrong to me, you know.
Yeah.
You better be thinking about it. That was a building. That's what it was.
Right.
It was a building.
Mm-hmm.
My Father's house. What do you call it? And the prophets said that life would flow out of Jerusalem. See, so he went up. This was like a place it was going to go out from. When the day of Pentecost came, what the prophets prophesied was going to flow out from Jerusalem. A fountain would be opened for sin and uncleanness in Jerusalem. And the new covenant would be announced. And what Jesus announced at the hometown synagogue, when he preached from Isaiah 61, would all come to pass in Jerusalem. So he went up to Jerusalem. It was the holy city, called the holy city, Isaiah 52:1. Now I don't doubt that the environs of Jerusalem looked different to Jesus than to most people. It was incidentally the only city Jesus wept over. Jesus never wept over Rome or like Alexandria, huh? He never wept Constantinople.
Yeah.
He never wept over any of those cities. The only city he ever did weep over was Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Not even Bethlehem or Nazareth.
Uh-huh. This is something to think about, anyway. If you'd only known, he said, if you'd only known.
That's right.
How often I would have gathered you unto myself as a hen gathers her chicks, and you wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
You wouldn't do it. So now your house is left unto you desolate. You're not going to see me again until you say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Mm-hmm. They haven't said it yet, but they're going to say it.
Amen.
Now Jesus goes up to the feast of Jerusalem, and there's a by the sheep market, there was a pool there. The sheep market, we understand that this was actually a gate where sheep were brought in for either sacrifice or for marketing. And this sheep, called Sheep Gate in Scripture, it was rebuilt by Eliashib the high priest and his brethren the priest during the rebuilding project of Nehemiah. They built this was part of the wall. See, the wall surrounded, there were gates in the wall,
yeah.
And this was one of the gates, one of the entry points, exit points there. Nehemiah's project took place about 500 years before this.
Yeah.
Sheep gate's still there. It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's interesting that this was a time wasn't characterized by fads,
yeah. Uh-huh.
And fashion. See, that we live in a time like this. You won't live a year some major fads change the whole landscape of things.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that isn't the way it used to be. In fact, Daniel, speaking of a time of decline, said that there would be an increase in knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite amazing when you think about it, but it hasn't really resulted in very good, very good things for the human race. But this was not that type sort of time. Isaiah said, wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of the time. See what? So here's a gate 500 years later.
Yeah, still there.
Here it is, still there. Now it was called in the Hebrew tongue, it was called Bethesda. This is the only place in the entire Bible that word is mentioned, Bethesda. Here it is, the only place. It's in the Hebrew tongue. In the Hebrew tongue, it's called Bethesda. Now the Hebrew tongue is mentioned 6 times in Scripture, the Hebrew tongue. And it's also called a Jew's language. And when Saul of Tarsus was confronted by Jesus, Jesus spoke to him in Hebrew.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Spoke to him in Hebrew. I want to say a word about the Jew's language because it's a significant language. I'd discuss this with some notable linguists. Because I suspected it was a unique language, but I didn't know enough about linguists and etymology to substantiate it, so they told me, yes, it is. It's a unique language. Like the word coincidence, there's no Hebrew word for coincidence. Things like this. And they said that it was like a theological language. The language itself suggests God.
Mm-hmm.
The language itself does. Mm-hmm. Hebrew tongue. Now, you may recall, of course, in Nehemiah's day, the language had become distorted.
Mm-hmm.
In Nehemiah's day. And here's what Nehemiah said about it. In those days also, I saw Jews that had married wives of Ashdod and Ammon and Moab, and their children spake half the speech in the speech of Ashdod, and could not speak in the Jews' language, but according to the language of each people. Now, Nehemiah got angry about this.
Yes.
He was incensed. He said, I contended with them, I cursed them, smote certain of them, and plucked off their hair. Whew, boy.
Yeah.
Whew, boy, he'd be visiting the psychiatrist in our day.
Yeah, that's right.
Plucked off their hair and made them swear by God, saying, ye shall not give your daughters unto their sons, nor take their daughters unto your sons for yourselves. Did not Solomon, king of Israel, sin by these things? Yet among many nations was there no king like him who was beloved of his God, and God made him king over all Israel. Nevertheless, even him did outlandish women cause to sin. Shall we then hearken unto you to do all this great evil, to transgress against our God and marry in strange wives? Well, this same thing has happened in the church.
Yes, that's right.
The same thing, with one exception. It doesn't appear there's much concern about it. It's unequal yokes. God's very particular about this now.
Yes.
Now, if you're converted after you're married and you have your unequal yoke, then there's ways you can deal with it. But if you're unmarried, you better not marry an unbeliever if you're a believer. It's an unequal yoke.
Yep.
And you're on the divine hit list when you do that. I'll not overlook it.
There's enough trouble
in those relationships anyway without something like that.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
See, the book point out the Hebrew language. See, that's there's reasons why he said it says in the Hebrew thing. It was more exact. It was more, it said more than other languages, than other languages said. Yes.
In that kind of an arrangement, there has to be a compromise in order for progress to be made, because when yoked together, both of them have to go in this in one direction. You can't go two different directions when yoked.
Mm-hmm.
So when unequally yoked, you're taking the risk of having to go in another direction. Someone's pulling, yes.
That's right.
And then at the same time, they're refusing to go your way, too. So, yeah, it's very dangerous. It's a constant standstill. Yeah.
Yes. Mm.
Mm-hmm.
Pool of Bethesda. Now, Bethesda means house of mercy. It was a large pool. I gather we'd like it something like a swimming pool. It was not just a little wading pool type thing. It was a large pool. And some suppose that this is the king's pool to which Nehemiah referred, Nehemiah 2:14. Now, it says it had five porches. Some versions say portico. The New International colonnades, doorways, covered porches, so forth. So I found a picture of a portico or the type of thing we're talking about, a covered porch. Now remember that the building was probably rather large, the multitude of folks. So it was a covered porch that was open around, and it had five of these, like something like a dormer is on a roof. This was what it was on the ground. And there was a great multitude. Now, when the Bible says great multitude, that is what it means. Great multitude of impotent folk. Impotent means paralyzed. And he mentions of blind, halt, that means lame, and withered, that bodily parts are dried up. Great multitude of them rot on these five porches. Now, frequent mention in the scripture is made of the staggering number of sick people that were in, particularly in Galilee and Judea. And that's even after Jesus' ministry, there still was a host of them brought to Peter, remember. After all the healings he did, there still was a staggering number of ill people and demon-possessed people in this country. And he asked, well, why? Well, there's a reason why. There's a reason why Moses told him this would happen.
Uh-huh.
Moses told him this would happen. Here's what he said. Deuteronomy 28:59-61. Then the Lord will make thy plagues. That's if you don't do what I say. Then the Lord will make thy plagues wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues of long continuance, and sore sicknesses of long continuance. He will bring upon thee all the diseases of Egypt, also every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of the law. That's exactly.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is. That's why there were so many sick people in Canaan. That is why.
Yeah.
God told them that's what was going to happen. He's going to go into that country. Don't hobnob with the inhabitants of the city, of the country. Mm-hmm. Don't mingle with them. Don't intermarry them. Don't learn their ways. He told them. It was very plain. He told them, don't learn their ways. Don't do it. Mm-hmm. And if you don't keep this law, what'll happen? This is what happened. And there were so many of them. And after, there never was a time when it was completely purged. With so many, such a staggering number of these people. Here's one place, one city where they were, and a great multitude of them were in these five porches, and they were gathered together in hopes that when the water was agitated, the first one in would be healed. Now, if that hadn't happened, these people wouldn't have been there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Some people think that this is a fictitious account. Oh, they do. In fact, the text we just read, an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the trouble in the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. Mm-hmm. All right, now the following versions of Scripture completely omit. Good News Bible, Good Speeds Bible, God's Word Bible, NIV, New Revised Standard, Revised Standard, English Standard, God's Word, Net Bible, New Jerusalem Bible, New Living Translation, Weymouth, Williams, and Montgomery, to name on him a few. They don't even include that in their text. Well, I'm for including it.
Amen. Amen.
An angel went down. Had to be on a commission, you know. Just had to be a commission. Angel went down. And it was at a certain season. At a certain season. Certain time. One version says from time to time. At certain times. Set time. Young's literal says, I like that. Set time. At a set time. But it wasn't a time known to men. It wasn't like always on July 5th. It wasn't like that, because the people had to come.
Yeah.
Maybe there were some kind of indicators, but I get the picture that you didn't really know when this was gonna happen. That sounds more like God.
Yeah, that's Brother Given, I was thinking
that the Lord, running the tape backwards now, the Lord could have had the angel do that as a magnet to get those people there, so Jesus could get there.
Yeah,
because
right.
The teaching that's going to happen after that's pretty
you're
profound.
On it.
Yeah,
you're
he
on
has
it.
A way of doing things
that's
like that.
That's exactly
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Yes.
It was God setting up the environment.
That's yeah. right. Yeah. Yes.
Amen.
It was like the blind man that was healed.
Mm-hmm.
It, neither him nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God might
Amen.
Be
yes.
Amen.
Amen.
His whole life, 40 years,
yeah.
was for
yeah.
that
yeah.
one.
That's
day.
Right.
Exactly.
See
yes.
that? Now you're... This is exactly it.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is what the text is all about. It's a record of God's working. So he's arranging the environment for a successful, or successful is not the word, for a effectual
yeah.
ministry of the Son.
Because
the Son didn't do a lot of like private. Some things he did privately, like raising Jairus' daughter. There were some in Peter's mother-in-law. There were things he did that were kind of private. Most of it was public, because that it wouldn't justify God to send a Savior who worked privately.
Even the private things didn't stay private.
That's right. It was noised abroad. See, a Savior of the world can't be sent to do something in a sequestered area. It was the land of Canaan. He didn't minister in Italy. Because Canaan had been, that's what that land was about.
Uh-huh. Yes.
That land was given to Abraham as the locus for the ministry of Jesus.
Yes.
And the people were cultured so they could kind of make sense out of a Savior being there.
That certainly makes you think about time in a different frame.
Mm-hmm. It does.
Even a person's whole life.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've sensed that by way of confession. I've sensed that in my own life. I can tell that there's been like periods mm-hmm. where I learned certain things that set me up for. And then I come across somebody that would say something that I'd never heard before, but it made sense because I've been kind of oriented
yeah,
for it. And you can, it's amazing what people you can learn from. Yes.
It's interesting that this pool is called the House of Mercy.
Yes, right.
And that God is using an angel as a tool of mercy
yeah.
here. And that the angels themselves were never recipients of mercy.
Mm-hmm.
But through this, God is teaching them
yeah.
this aspect of himself.
Amen.
And what it is for him to be merciful.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Now, too, we're introduced to a new kind of angelic activity.
Yes.
Here's the angels instrumental in healing.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. You say, when he got in the water, there appeared to be like healing properties.
Uh-huh. They can kill pretty good too.
Oh, yeah. They sure can. They can deliver too pretty well.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Now, what God uses to heal a person is incidental. He can use a word.
Uh-huh.
He can use agitated in waters.
Uh-huh.
He can use a lump of figs.
Yeah.
He can use some salt in a pot. See, God, the means God uses is are incidental, but all of them show some aspect of,
yes.
of God. He can use a doctor,
yeah.
beloved physician, shall we say.
Yeah.
Now, it says that this was not a mass healing. It's not when the waters started moving.
Uh-huh.
Everybody get in, just the first one in. That's
right.
The only one. It was a discretionary healing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was glad that's not what happened on the day of Pentecost.
Yeah.
What if on Pentecost only the first one?
Yeah.
And got the remission of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit, see?
Mm-hmm.
But here it was,
that's right.
Just to let you know
uh-huh.
that this was a heavenly work.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was a work, kind of work you couldn't deduce that this was like some accident that happened. Only the first one. That's all. But this tells you what hope will do.
Yeah, that's right.
There's a multitude of people there, and everybody knows only one.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm showing you now what hope can do
that's
to a person
right.
if you have hope.
Uh-huh.
This is what hope can do for a person. Only
yeah.
one's going to be healed.
Yeah.
The porches are filled up.
That's right.
Yeah.
Everybody hoping they're the one.
Yeah, uh-huh.
That's what hope will do for you now.
Yeah.
That's what hope will do for you.
Amen.
All of this, of course, postulates that the people had seen some evidence that
yeah.
this.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they wouldn't. If there was no evidence,
uh-huh.
eventually the crowd would have.
That's right.
See? Now, let me tell you. If the professed church does not stick out there before people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People whose lives are changed and who will not live in sin.
Yeah. Yeah.
And who will follow Jesus wherever he goes. If
yeah.
they do not present that, the crowds won't come.
Amen.
You're going to have to hire a marketer.
Yeah, that's
right.
Which just happens to be what they do. Remember in the early church, 3,000 day of Pentecost?
Mm-hmm.
Next count, 5,000 men. It still didn't count women. 5,000 men.
Mm-hmm.
Then multitudes of men and women.
Uh-huh.
Why?
Yeah.
It was genuine
yeah.
fruit. You were seeing what happened. Then in the early church, people that weren't acceptable, they were the exceptions.
Yeah.
So in Ananias and Sapphira, they were the exceptions.
Yeah.
But when they were taken out, great fear come on everybody. There were some people said, don't go there.
Yeah.
And what if one of the local marquees in church in town here, one of the local marquees said, liars fall dead during service? You know, what if that? It purges out the audience, I'll tell you that. What I'm illustrating here is that the display of the real work God does is the way God markets. That's the way. A city set on a hill can't, not ought not, can't be hid.
Amen.
But a city that's not set on a hill, who wants to see it? That's the way it is. See, in Christ Jesus, there is a real deliverance from sin. There's real instruction by the grace of God on how to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and live righteously, soberly, and godly in this present world. See, there, this is really what happens.
Yes.
But what happens is the people have to coordinate with the message.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'm telling you that where the people don't coordinate with the message, Satan has given people a different message.
That's right.
That does coordinate, that sinful people that claim they're Christians coordinate with this message. Well, God loves everybody. God loves you just the way you are. See, they've invented a message that looks justified by these pretenders. But the message is powerless. The gospel is the power. It's the power of God. But it has to be preached, you understand. Has to be preached. So Jesus announced in his hometown synagogue, "The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted." That's hard to do, heal the brokenhearted. That's, and to preach deliverance to the captives. Not the loose captives, preach deliverance to them. There's no one captive to sin that is in a prison with doors.
Yeah, right.
Like Samson took the gates of Gaza off, Jesus took the cell doors off. There's no cell doors.
Yeah.
Anyone that wants out can just walk out.
Amen.
Jesus is announcing, you're free. Mm-hmm. Just like Paul and Silas in the prison, there were no doors, you know.
Yeah.
But they stayed there, but when the prison keeper came, they walked out. There was no... Walked out. So whatsoever disease these people had, made no difference what it was, first one in was healed of whatever. Mm-hmm. Now this is the message we have for the world. The world can talk about addiction and long-term addiction and how difficult it is and your struggles with sin and blah, blah, blah. But here's the message we got. We don't care what your sin is or how deeply you're ensconced in it. God can convert an Ethiopian eunuch who doesn't understand the Bible and turn around and convert a fierce persecutor of the church. Whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever.
Amen.
There were people given over to cultism in Ephesus. They gathered their books together and burned them in publicly.
Yes.
Boy, we could do with some book burnings today, I'll tell you.
Amen.
Why did people do that? It's because the salvation of God is effective.
Amen.
It does exactly what God says it does. People are really born again. That's not a simile. That's a real thing.
Yes.
They're really born again. There's no spiritual condition or moral condition that's not effectively addressed by justification.
Amen.
You're justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. This is very real. And if it's preached properly, it'll purge the conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And that's one of the plaguing consciences. No one wants a plaguing conscience. But salvation addresses that. So what a blessed record this is, a perfect depiction of what Jesus does in salvation.
Amen.
There's a place where it happens. In this case, it's not a physical place, but it's a place that a person can get where they're acutely conscious of their own need of Christ, and they are at the same time made aware of the access to Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, amen.
That's the place.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone who's ever got to that place never left sad.
Yeah, that's right.
They always went on their way rejoicing. Now, the role we play in all of this, we're some of the folk that got in the pool before. That's what we are. And
yeah.
So we testify, look, I am what I am by the grace of God. If people knew you before and knew what you were,
yes.
It'll take them a while.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you by experience. It'll take them a while for them to believe you really changed. But
Eventually,
when they see a lame man walking enough,
mm-hmm.
maybe they see him jumping and leaping and praising God in
yeah.
the temple courts, they say, that was the guy that used to be sitting outside there.
Yeah.
He got in the pool.
Yeah.
I think I'll close. Any of you have a word you'd like to add today?
Amen.
Yes?
People had to be alert that were sitting around that pool. It says at the disturbing of the water, they moved.
Yeah.
So they had to be looking at it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's an exhortation to us.
Mm-hmm.
Says your affections on things above
mm-hmm.
is not... it's not static.
Yeah.
It's not something that you can be doing involuntarily.
Uh-huh.
You've got to be very active in setting your affections on things above, because it requires all of your attention.
Yeah.
Expecting.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, there's, you know, I like this point that he makes, that there was a feast of the Jews, that, you know, we people should expect when there's a meeting that God's ordained that something is going to happen.
That's right.
That God's going to work. If
That's
you
right.
come and you by faith have set aside your life and you come together with a brother in order to be blessed and built up, you should expect to be blessed and built up.
That's right.
God's going to do what he said.
That's right.
And these things were like you've already said, these things were set up by God, as it were, so that we would be able to make the connection.
You know, if he had just allowed one person to be at the pool, it wouldn't have had the effect that this had here.
That's right.
He's
yeah.
telling you here that the access is to everybody.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Salvation is to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Even if only one.
Yeah.
But if the witness is true and the people are properly prepared, it won't be just one.
Yeah, that's right.
It wasn't in the beginning and it will not be now. Uh-huh. Yes.
Being healed of an infirmity, that's a pretty big thing. And so likewise, we as God's people don't want to be surprised or shocked when God works in ways such as this.
That's
we
right.
want to gather from this to be noted for people that expect uh-huh. God to work in work that which is impossible with men.
Yes, Brother Tony.
Yes, I was appreciative of how you discussed that about the history, and that was in part of your introduction.
Yeah,
it is absolutely true. You know, we always talk about Jewish history as recorded in the Old Testament, but actually it's not. It's really just God setting the stage for
right.
Jesus Christ.
That's right.
He's only discussing significant events that are there only because of God's got Christ in view.
Mm-hmm.
We saw this this past Lord's Day where there was a chapter, and it seemed like it didn't really fit in there. It just in the lesson. But you know, if you understand what God is doing, and then it all of a sudden it was important. But it looked like it might have been chronologically out of place or something like that. But really, it was all about what God is doing. And then when you understand it, it makes a lot more sense.
And it makes a difference when you can see what God's doing.
Mm-hmm.
It makes a big difference. Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I read a world history book some time ago, not too long ago, and of course the word blah, blah, blah could be used for most of it. You know, my son-in-law is Indian, another's black, so their skin color doesn't matter to me, but a lot of black people in Africa are trying to find some kind of a self-esteem through black history.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, the honest truth is, we teach a little bit of history in our school. There's not much from human history worth really studying.
That's right.
It doesn't really dignify human beings, people. It just shows their weaknesses. It shows their power struggles. It shows, you know, there's a few things you can pull out of history to use for an example, but it's what the Lord has said about people
Amen.
That matter.
Amen.
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 Yes.
It's
Amen.
Not a well.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
Yes.
Yeah. This the way he says this, it's more than interesting. It's God doing this. He says that an angel went down, troubled the waters. Remember, these are paralyzed
yeah.
people. He says that then whoever stepped in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course, you know, later he's going to say, I don't have anybody to help me in.
Yeah.
So there were some there that were instrumental in helping these.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, now if that isn't a picture of the church and how we work together and,
Amen.
You know, we helping each
yeah,
other get in
may,
the water.
There may have been people yeah. that helped someone else get in and lost it themselves.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Sorry. Well, in Africa, we have a lot of beggars, too. Now, the truth is, some of the beggars make a lot more money than those at work. I got to tell you the truth.
Same here.
And I personally, maybe yes. I'm a little cynical, but I kind of think this guy wasn't trying that hard. Because Jesus said, do you want to get well?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And I think people can be like that. They're sin.
Yeah.
They mollycoddle some area of their life that has some sin in it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think people have been convicted enough
yeah.
by good, sound teaching and by examples
mm-hmm.
to realize they need to overcome all their sins.
Amen.
Not
yeah.
just leave some dormant or to put some in the
yeah.
closet somewhere.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we'll find that time beat the guy down.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You'd think that he'd try, whoever brought him there, he'd put him by the edge of the,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
Well, Aaron, yes.
Yeah. Every miracle that Jesus did was a parable.
Yeah.
Everything is
yeah.
directly related to what he's still doing
mm-hmm.
in salvation. And so he never did a miracle to fulfill some carnal operation or some
mm-hmm.
worldly purpose or agenda.
Yeah.
Which means that all of these miracles were more. It was more than just a healing. It was
mm-hmm.
more than just a miraculous meal.
Yeah.
It was more than a just
yeah.
a resurrection. In fact, in the case of the time of Lazarus being raised from the dead, it said many of the Jews believed because of Lazarus being raised from
mm-hmm.
the dead. So this is not just a an exploit of power.
Yeah.
There's teaching.
Amen.
There's actually
Amen.
Revelation in the miracles.
Not like entertainment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Why only one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I don't know why.
There's a great
yeah.
multitude there.
Yeah.
Great multitude, but that teaches you that people have to want to be the one.
Yeah, yeah.
That you, God doesn't save people in clusters either. And so that's how you have to approach. It's me, oh Lord, stand in the need of prayer.
Yeah.
Because, yeah. Yes, Brother Justin.
The point is that things that are impossible with men are possible with God.
That's right.
And the man with the withered hand, who is going to give him a hand as whole as the other?
Right.
Who was going to give it to him?
Mm-hmm.
Was any of the physicians
yeah.
going to give it to him? The Pharisees definitely weren't going to give it to him.
Mm-hmm.
But see, Jesus, he just says, stretch forth your hand, and it was
mm-hmm.
made as whole as the other.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what a person's caught up in. They can't overcome it if they believe. They believe
yeah,
they can
uh-huh.
be restored as whole as the other.
Yeah, one ruler of the synagogue says, come on some other day and be healed.
Yeah, yeah.
And he didn't announce the schedule on what day that would be.
That's right. Yeah.
All right, did you want to say something before we go on to prayer there, Brother Jeff?
Want me to greet the brother? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you.
Should I wait till I get there? Or?
Yeah, up here you'll get on. You'll